The Pleiadian Mission, A Time of Awareness. Part 4. Contact from the Pleiades. As creation moved to allow the procreation of the old spirit form into the world as Eduard Meier, the unseen hand of Pleiadian consciousness gently guided the newborn infant into life. He would be watched over and cared for from that day forward. The importance of this new lifetime could not be understated, for the Pleiadians were aware of the difficult times to come in the new age. Through this new prophet they would see to it that the wisdom of thousands of years of accumulated lifetimes would find its way into the hearts and minds of the people of Earth. Of the seven Pleiadians who helped guide the old spirit form into the world, one, an elderly man named Sfath, decided to take on the task of watching over young Eduard and seeing to his education. In each lifetime that the old spirit form had served as a prophet, it was necessary in the early years of material life to awaken his sleeping spiritual memories and bring forth the wisdom and abilities that would be needed to perform his missing. In this lifetime it would be Sfath's job to connect with the spirit form who had become Eduard and prepare him for the tasks ahead. Sfath began to listen to young Edward's thoughts, which were just developing, but had no plans to make any contact with him for several years. However, at the age of 6 months, Eduard suddenly developed a case of pneumonia that seemed quite serious. For several days Sfath carefully observed Edward's health, which rapidly became very critical. His mother called in the family doctor. After a short examination, he informed Mrs. Meier that young Eduard was in a coma and would probably not make it through the night. After the doctor left the house and Eduard was left alone in his room, Sfath decided to take matters into his own hands. Without the knowledge of Edward's parents, Sfath came into the bedroom and reversed the disease. By morning Edward's health had returned. Mrs. Meier believed that her prayers had been answered and that a miracle had saved her baby. She would never know her home had been paid a visit by a kindly old man from another world. It wasn't until Eduard was 5 years old that Sfath decided to open contact with the child by stimulating his mind. At first simple thoughts and ideas were telepathically sent to Eduard, challenging him to try to understand their meaning and to respond. This was Sfath's way of getting Eduard to use his mind and wake up his old memories. It was easy enough to contact the spiritual side of Eduard, but the material consciousness was not yet trained in how to use its spiritual self, so the telepathic thoughts went largely unanswered and uncomprehended. 2 years passed as Eduard continued to receive thoughts from Sfath without really understanding their meaning. He did not have the knowledge to comprehend the significance of the strange visions that had been flowing into his head. Sfath had been monitoring Edward's thoughts and decided that now it was time to open up the spiritual side of Eduard, bringing forth the old memories and knowledge that would help him interpret the meaning of his transmissions. To do this, Sfath sent the telepathic command to Eduard to walk out into the forest near his home and to wait for him. Eduard had become accustomed to the telepathic voice by now and was not alarmed or intimidated, so he simply obeyed and went out into the woods and waited. Sfath was high above the earth in his spaceship and could sense Eduard was responding to his request and was now waiting in the forest. The Pleiadian spacecraft was locked onto Edward's brain patterns, and quickly darted down into the atmosphere of Earth and headed for Switzerland. Eduard looked up and saw a small silver dot in the sky. It suddenly streaked toward him like a flash of light and quickly appeared on the ground as a pear-shaped craft. It was unlike anything he had seen before. The craft had arrived quickly, without making a sound, and gently set down in the meadow where Eduard was waiting. From inside the ship Sfath had carefully scanned the area to make sure that there was no one else around before stepping out of the craft. Eduard seemed very calm for a young boy of 7 and followed Sfath into his spaceship as he was directed. Within a few seconds the craft left the Earth and was over 40 miles up in orbit. There was no feeling of motion, so Eduard had no idea where he was until he looked out a window and saw the Earth far below. Sfath was expecting that a short ride in a Pleiadian craft would jar loose some old memories in Edward's mind, causing him to search himself for their meaning. Sfath wanted him to discover for himself that he had lived many previous lives, during which he had ridden in a similar spacecraft. Sfath said not a word, but observed Edward's thoughts as the craft quickly returned to Earth and quietly settled back down on the ground. Eduard was still speechless and seemed to be deep in thought. He had not said a word during the entire trip. Sfath was content with the experience and knew that Edward's mind would be very busy making some old connections. Edward turned to look at Sfath's ship. It had vanished just as suddenly and silently as it had appeared. Edward was suddenly left alone in the forest to walk home with a lot of new ideas in his head. These ideas would take some time to sort out. Over the next 2 years, Sfath began to send telepathic messages more frequently, and Edward began to respond and offer answers to the many questions posed to him. He was beginning to remember many things and make some connections, but there was a lot he didn't understand yet. Sfath could tell that Edward's mind was ready and once again directed him to a meeting place at a remote spot in the forest. This meeting would be different, for it was time to open up Edward's mind and let him know about his mission. He would have to decide for himself if he wished to continue or stop, for Sfath would not coerce him into a stressful lifetime as a prophet. In order for Edward to make an intelligent decision, Sfath would first have to provide explanations and educate him in many ways. Once Edward was aboard the spacecraft and they were safely up in orbit above the Earth where nothing could disturb them, Sfath began to explain to Edward that he would have to prepare himself for a very serious and extremely important mission. He would have to decide for himself whether or not he would bear the burden of this mission for which he had been born. After many explanations, Sfath placed a device on Edward's head which made a direct contact with his mind and unlocked many old memories and knowledge. More importantly, he brought forward the awareness of the language of spirit that is deep within us all. This language of spirit is a language of signs and symbols with which one can interpret the meaning of telepathic messages that are sent to the spiritual side of oneself. This immediately allowed Edward to understand the meaning of some of the transmissions he had received from Sfath. Within minutes, his understanding of himself and his mission became much clearer. At this point, he made the decision to commit to his part of the mission. Happy that Edward had responded so favorably, Sfath returned him to Earth. Edward now had the mental capacity of a 35-year-old man and would be able to understand the complex concepts of science and mind that he would now receive telepathically from Sfath. He also possessed spiritual awareness and knowledge far exceeding that of anyone else on Earth. The device that was placed around his head while he had been on the ship had opened up his spiritual self and rekindled much of the old spirit's accumulated wisdom that dwelled deep within his mind. Everything was in place now for Edward to learn and develop into the prophet of his time. After several more years of telepathic education from Sfath and other extraterrestrials, Edward was told he would now be left alone for 11 years to mature and contemplate what he had learned. He would need some time for himself, to travel, to meet his mate, to start a family, and then settle down, before the Pleiadians would revive the contacts. It was during these years that he lost his left arm in a bus accident in Iskenderun, Turkey on the 3rd of August, 1965. This was an important event in his life as it had been foretold to him by the extraterrestrials 7 years prior its happening. Billy marks this event as part of his spiritual development and carries his left arm like a badge of honor. It was 1965, and the 250 Pleiadians who lived and worked in the vast underground complex under Switzerland had taken relatively little interest in the development of young Edward that had been left up to Sfath. They had been busy with their normal duties of monitoring the thoughts of Earth's leaders and studying the effects of the New Age on mass consciousness. Now it was time to choose someone to give Edward special attention, and prepare for the series of physical contacts that would be necessary to educate him as a prophet. Simjace prepares for her mission. A Pleiadian woman named Simjace volunteered to take on the mission of being Edward's teacher. She had never been on Earth and was not part of the underground complex team that had been observing Earth for the past 310 years. She was fascinated by the idea of working with the people of Earth. For her it meant that she would have to learn a great deal about the planet, its history, science, languages, its people and, of course, Eduard Meier. Simjace lived on Era, the home planet of the Pleiades, where the level of consciousness was quite different from that of Earth, where she would soon be spending so much time. This would pose some problems for her, so she set about her task of preparation slowly. First, she studied the German language that was spoken by Edward. The information storage systems available to her in the Pleiades had on file the King's German that is spoken on Earth during the 16th and 17th century. This was very similar to the Swiss German that was spoken by Eduard and would allow her to understand his thoughts once she began to monitor them. For the next 10 years, she studied the history of Earth and its people over the past several million years so that she could educate Eduard. She would occasionally listen in on his thinking so she would be better prepared to communicate with him when the time came. Throughout all of this time, Eduard was unaware that she was listening to his thoughts or that she was studying him. During this time, Eduard had taken on the nickname of Billy, a name he had picked up while watching American movies about Billy the Kid. Very fond of American westerns, Eduard thought of himself as a cowboy, and thus became Billy. He wore a cowboy hat and often carried a gun and holster just like his movie heroes, Gene Autry and Roy Rogers. In order to understand more about his fellow man and to learn about the many philosophies of life, Billy left Switzerland and traveled to the East to continue his education. As the years went by, he continued his travels through many countries, including India, Pakistan, and Greece, where he met and married a Greek woman named Calliope, who went by the nickname of Poppy. They returned to Switzerland, to the town of Hinwell, to start their family. Employed as a night watchman, Billy used his time alone to study the many lessons of life that he had learned over the years in preparation for his mission. He practiced meditation constantly in order to gain access to the spheres of higher consciousness. Sfath had made many references to the previous lives that had been lived by Billy's spirit, encouraging him to find out about them for himself. Through meditation, it was possible for him to connect with his spiritual self, the doorway to the memories of former lifetimes and the lessons learned. Billy was very puzzled by the idea that he had lived previous lives as a prophet serving the Pleiadian mission, and gave much thought to unraveling this mystery. Billy's first contact with Simjace. Simjace was comfortable with her mission and the knowledge she had acquired and felt she was ready to start the contacts. Just before leaving for Earth, she spent a few days practicing with a language specialist to brush up on the King's German, and then she was ready. It was on Tuesday, the 28th of January, 1975 at 1 p.m. Earth time, when Simjace sent her telepathic message to Billy. He was working at home with his tape recorder, trying to capture the voice of spirits. He had been trying for months, with poor results, when her thoughts suddenly came into his mind. She was directing him to get his camera and meet her at a remote spot to which she would lead him. She could tell by his thoughts that he was surprised. They didn't know each other yet, for she had not introduced herself or made her presence known to him during the years she had studied him. Part of his surprise was that he was not expecting contact for another year, but the thoughts in his head made it quite clear he was being led into a remote area for a meeting with a visitor from another world. As the silver spacecraft floated high above Earth in the clear Swiss sky, she continued to send telepathic messages to Billy, guiding him into the remote forest area. He had driven through a small village and, within minutes, was heading into a local forest. As he rode his small moped along the lonely road, he once again felt the thoughts of Simjace come into his mind and guide him to move on down the road to a more remote location. Looking at his watch, he noticed it was 2:12 p.m. and that he had been driving for a full hour. Contact from the Pleiades. In her telepathic messages, Simjace suggested that Billy bring his camera, for she was going to allow photos to be taken of her spacecraft as proof of her existence. It had been decided by the Pleiadian Council that the main purpose of the first visits would be to provide evidence of their existence. It was time to awaken the people of Earth to the idea that they were not alone. In the past, they had made contact with other Earth people for the purpose of making their presence known, but had not allowed any photos to be taken. At that time, they were concerned that this would have been taking the proof of their existence too far, causing undue mental stress on some people. They had to be careful of the manner in which they exposed themselves to the masses of Earth, and it was clear to them after years of study that the minds of most Earth people at that time were too fragile to handle the idea of visitors from another world. Now, however, they felt the time was right to allow photos of the craft to gently awaken us to the idea that we are not alone in the universe. From out of the clouds, Simjace guided her ship and hurried toward the meeting place in the quiet meadow in the Swiss countryside. Even though the ship was very quiet and flew noiselessly, Billy noticed the rustle of the birds and wildlife that signaled the approach of an alien energy to the forest. He parked his moped by a tree and stood motionless as the sleek, silvery craft set down in the remote meadow. As soon as the UFO had landed, Billy walked toward it to observe it more closely and to get a better photograph. But about 100 meters before reaching the UFO, he was stopped by some unseen force. It felt like he was pushing against the winds of a completely soundless storm. With all his power, he tried to fight against the energy field to move forward, but he could only advance a few feet because the counteracting force was simply too great. Billy decided to sit down on the ground, stare at the spaceship, and wait for the occupant to come out. Simjace could tell that Billy was mentally calm and was prepared to greet her, so she opened the hatch to her spacecraft and stepped out onto the ground. As she walked toward him, she could tell his thoughts were all about her appearance. Billy was thinking that her clothes were rather familiar, a cosmic suit, similar in form to some earthly products, but very pliant and light, he analyzed. Actually, the suit was more like an overall with a peculiar gray color. Very close up, it reminded him of the skin of an elephant, which he had seen once in Africa and again in a zoo in Switzerland. The suit fit tightly to the body and appeared to be quite durable. Around her neck was a metal ring, apparently for the purpose of fastening a helmet of some type. Evidently, the Earth's atmosphere was suitable for her, for she never required a helmet during her visits to Billy. As people tend to do, Billy was quickly looking her over and forming his opinion of her. Her head was exposed and she was easily recognized as being a young woman. The look on her face was free and open, with nothing to suggest that she was superhuman or carried a superior attitude. Her manner was that of a normal-looking human being who just happened to be of extraterrestrial origin. Billy could not ignore the fact that she was also very beautiful. Her walk was that of a normal person, only stronger and more self-assured. Her long, red hair shone in the sunlight as she stopped in front of him. Slowly she extended her hand to Billy, seized him by the arm, and pulled him up on his feet. Her grip was strong and sure, but very pleasant and confident. They walked toward Billy's motorbike where they both just sat down in the dry grass. Then she began to speak, not in his home language of Swiss German, but in the older King's German that she had learned. This caused her to have an accent that was peculiar to him, but he had no trouble understanding her. Simjace introduced herself, explaining that she was from a small cluster of stars called the Pleiades. She told him she had been listening to his thoughts for several years in preparation for this meeting and understood his character very well. She knew that Billy was a fearless man whose integrity could be counted on. For quite some time, she and her people had wanted to come in contact with an Earth human being who was sincere and really wanted to be helpful to their mission. Many times before, the Pleiadians had tried physical contacts with humans, but the people chosen turned out to be unwilling, and also often lacked loyalty and sincerity. Some of those chosen feared for their safety and kept silent about their contacts, or were afraid that they would be thought of as insane by their friends and family. She told Billy to relax, that today she had information to impart and to only interrupt her if he did not understand something. She promised there would be more meetings in the future, and he could ask all the questions that he wanted. Today, for their first meeting, she simply wanted to introduce herself and let him know what to expect in the future. To begin with, she and her people were concerned that so many people here on Earth were claiming to be in contact with the Pleiadians and claiming to have ridden in their beamships, as she called them. This simply was not true, for they had not conducted physical contacts with any Earth people for some time. The same held true for certain UFO organizations which had been trying to gain knowledge about their beamships, but they had no photos that were really authentic. There are many photos in existence which appear to be extraterrestrial craft, but are really nothing more than blurred lights. Most of the photos, of which she was aware, were nothing more than fabricated deceptions manufactured by dishonest people seeking wealth and fame. Simjace wanted to make it clear to the people of Earth that her people had been coming to Earth for thousands of years and were not involved directly with the governments or political leaders. Only occasionally do they make contact with a chosen person such as Billy, and then it is only for the purpose of awakening people to the idea that they are not the only thinking, rational beings in the universe. Another point that she wanted to make clear was that she and her people were not superhuman and do not have supernatural powers. laser beams do not shoot from their eyes, and they do not have the strength of 10 Earthmen. In truth, they are human beings just like the people of Earth, but their knowledge and wisdom is far greater, especially in the technical and spiritual areas. It is their highly developed spiritual knowledge that enables them to use certain powers of spirit that seem like magic to us, such as telepathy, telekinesis, and access to higher realms of consciousness. These abilities also lie within the Earthman, but they are not as well developed. We should also be made aware, Simjace warned Billy, that there are many deceitful people on Earth who pretend that they are in contact with human beings from other planets in our own solar system, and even claim to have flown in their spacecraft. This is not true, for the planets they talk about are so desolate that human life is impossible there. Other planets, in contrast, have been lifeless for a long time or are in the first stages of development and do not support life in any form. There is no human life in our solar system except here on Earth and a few scattered bases manned by the Pleiadians and other races. Other solar systems beyond ours do exist with various forms of life, and not exclusively human. There are also many animal and even plant life forms that have evolved to higher forms of life. It was time for the people of Earth to know that many life forms exist who have reached advanced knowledge and travel through the universe, sometimes visiting Earth. Many of these otherworld travelers are malicious and should be considered very dangerous. The people of Earth should be on guard for these types, for they often fight and destroy everything that comes their way. Sometimes they will even destroy whole planets or civilizations and force the inhabitants into slavery. Part of her mission was to warn the Earth humans about these creatures, because the time rapidly approaches wherein a conflict with some of these beings will become unavoidable. Another part of her mission was directed toward our religions and the consequent subdevelopment of the human spirit. In future meetings, she wanted to spend some time in the education of spirit matters, so the people of Earth could learn about the one power that resides over the life and death of each creature. This is the creation that dictates the logic by which the universe and all life forms exist. This logic is absolute and forms the laws by which man must live. These laws are apparent in nature, and reveal the knowledge of life and the direction towards spiritual greatness, which embodies the goal of life. It was time for the Earthman to learn about the true meaning of life and how to live in peace and harmony with nature and the eternal energy of creation. This would be the subject of many of the future meetings. By studying the thoughts of Earth, the Pleiadians have also discovered that we are living under the wrong idea that gods are equal to the creation itself. We have also misled ourselves into believing that an Earth human being by the name of Emmanuel was the Son of God and the Lord of the universe. In future contacts, Simjace would explain in detail the role of gods within creation and provide us with the real truth about the life and teachings of Emmanuel, whom we call Jesus Christ. One further point in this area was that the Pleiadians and other extraterrestrial races have not come to Earth on behalf of a god to bring the Earth the long-awaited peace. Earth humans must learn that never can a god take the role of the creation or control the destiny or fate of the human being. A god is simply a physical being, a governor, and, moreover, a human being who has evolved to a level of great understanding and knowledge through millions of lifetimes. Gaining power through his knowledge, these beings usually exercise control over their fellow creatures. Those that are significantly less developed will believe that these self-styled gods have power over their lives, but they do not. Creation is the spiritual force that has the knowledge to create a universe, whereas a god is only a material being with knowledge of the human form and is subject to creation like all other life forms. It was also not true that the Pleiadians came to Earth on behalf of any god, for they are no longer governed by gods or rulers and now live completely free, enjoying their spiritual connection with creation. The creation itself never gives commands or demands worship in any fashion because it is an egoless, non-judgmental spiritual force. It is eternal knowledge that guides the growth of the universe, and that knowledge is never in need of commands or religions. The Pleiadians would like to bring this truth to the light of the world and make it known to human beings. It is an important part of their mission. If this does not happen, then it is possible that mankind will slowly destroy itself, or fall into complete spiritual darkness. Simjace then made it clear that there would be many more meetings, and she planned to spend a lot of time with Billy to pass on the information the Pleiadian Council felt was important for Earth. She had prepared for the coming contacts for several years, and had great hopes that the information she would provide would be useful in helping the people of Earth create a more peaceful future. Her objective today was only to introduce herself and let Billy know of her plans for the future. This would be all for their first meeting, and he could plan for her return within a week. She would contact him when she was coming, just as she did today. He would feel a cooling sensation on his forehead, followed by the telepathic transmission of thoughts that would let him know where to meet her. She would be careful to interrupt his thoughts only when he was open to it, and to not infringe on his privacy. Future contacts would be in her beamship, so they would have some privacy. She also intended to take him on flights into free cosmic space, so he could visit the other planets and see the solar system. It was okay for him to bring his camera, for they wanted to encourage him to take many pictures and bring them to the attention of the public. She would be more helpful in the future, posing her ship so that he could get some very good shots. Bidding Billy farewell, Simjace then walked toward the spacecraft that was sitting there quietly in the meadow, disappeared inside of the craft, and flew away within seconds. Billy took advantage of the opportunity and snapped several more photos as the ship disappeared over the forest. He knew from previous experience that you had to be quick if you wanted to get good pictures of these spacecraft, because they changed directions so quickly and disappeared in seconds. Just as Simjace had said, she began to return almost every week. Each time she would send the telepathic message to Billy, guiding him to a remote spot where they would be unnoticed. Billy would ride his moped to where he was directed and wait for the silver craft to show up. On most occasions he would bring him up into her beamship, especially since the Swiss weather can be so harsh most of the year. Here they could talk and have their meetings in private, and she shared with him the vast amount of knowledge that the Pleiadians felt was important for Earth. After each meeting, or contact as Billy called them, he would return home and type out what was said. Not trusting Billy's memory, Simjace had arranged for a special computer-like device to replay to Billy's mind all that was said at the contact, so he could type it down exactly. The device could read the memory of the meeting that was stored in the subconscious mind of Simjace and send it to the conscious mind of Billy, who was sitting at his typewriter. He would then hear the conversation in his head and type it. This was particularly hard for Billy, having only one arm, and made the job of typing very difficult. During the transmissions from Simjace, he would sit at the typewriter and be capable of typing 50 to 60 words a minute without stopping. He would normally have someone sitting beside him to change the paper as the continuous stream of knowledge flowed from his mind out onto the typewriter keys. This process would usually last for several hours, until either the transmission was complete or he was exhausted. The amount of work became overwhelming to Billy. He was having a contact almost every week, and at the same time he was a father and husband who needed to provide for his family. His wife, Poppy, had two kids, a house, and a husband to take care of, and she wasn't in the mood to hear that Billy was too busy having contacts with a nice-looking woman from another planet and had no time to work. It was several months before she began to take his contacts seriously and started to understand their importance. At each contact he would usually get the opportunity to bring his camera and shoot two or three rolls of film. Simjace wanted Billy to get the best UFO shots ever taken as proof to the public that his meetings and information were real. She and the members of the High Council of the Pleiades, to whom she had to answer, felt that many people on Earth were ready to take this step up in their consciousness. The pictures would be proof to some, and to others it would open up old memories of life on other worlds where ships such as these were common. She was well aware that there were many old Lyran spirits on Earth who had lived many lifetimes on other worlds far more advanced than here. Billy's pictures began to appear in magazines and newspapers in Switzerland and surrounding countries. They were all beautiful daytime photos that were very clear and distinct. They were so good that many people couldn't believe that they were real. But many of those who did believe came in droves to Billy's home in Hinwell. On Sundays the road to his house was packed with cars from all over, for everyone wanted to talk with the man who was in contact with the star people. Billy had made a promise to Simjace to tell everyone about his contacts and would refuse no one. He underestimated the scope of his promise, for people came by the thousands to ask their questions and look at his spectacular photos. His home life was ruined as people crawled through the windows, went through his drawer and stole his pictures, and made life miserable for himself and Poppy. The local townspeople were getting fed up with all of the traffic and commotion. Most of the villagers didn't believe his story and thought he was some kind of con man who was making this up. They didn't think this was amusing at all and wanted him out of their town. It wasn't long before Billy was forced to look for a new place for himself and his family to live. Billy found a nice, old farm in a remote area of the country that Sinjace pointed out would have a good chance of surviving the coming disasters around the turn of the century. On a viewing screen in her ship, she showed Billy the areas of Switzerland that would be most affected by coming volcanoes, fires, and more importantly, the rising water that was expected from overflowing oceans. These events would be happening around the advent of the 21st century. The farm was in a safe place in a little rural area called Schmidrudi, about 45 minutes east of Zurich. Here, Billy could live peacefully and continue his work safe from the coming natural disasters. Buying the farm was expensive, especially since Billy had no income other than the pension he received from the Swiss government. He would need some financial help from others in order to buy the farm. As luck would have it, an old friend came forward just at the right time and was able to offer enough money for a down payment on the farm, and things fell into place for him to move his family to their new home. Over that past year, many of those who had come to visit with him had expressed interest in helping him with his work of disseminating his informative contact notes to the public. So far, Billy had amassed over 1,000 pages of contact notes he had written of his meetings with the off-world visitors from the Pleiades. The information included was on many different subjects, from history to science to consciousness. Sinjace had been prompting him for months to get his notes in order and to make them available to the public, and she was most adamant that Billy should speak in public. All of this was proving to be too much for Billy. He just couldn't keep up with the workload, and public speaking was very difficult for him. He had tried on a couple of occasions to speak to small groups in neighboring cities, but he was ridiculed and laughed at, and he wanted no part of it anymore. Once the move to the farm at Schmidrudi had been accomplished, Billy decided to take Sinjace's suggestion that he form a group around him that could help him with his work. They could help him with his contact notes and other books he was writing, and possibly public speaking. Billy approached some of his followers who were most anxious to help out with the work, and a group was formed. They called themselves the Freie Interessengemeinschaft für Grenzgeistwissenschaften und Ufologiestudien, a rather long German phrase which means free community of interest in border and spiritual science and ufology. If you don't speak German, this is difficult to learn, so to most of the world the group has become known as the FIGU. There were 25 members in the original group, 15 of whom took up residence at the farm where Billy and Poppy had just moved. In honor of the special purpose of this new home they would all share, they decided to name the farm the Sinjace Silver Star Center. The FIGU members then began to take part in helping out around the Star Center, or Center as they called it, and took on special duties to help Billy with his writing. Some of the FIGU members helped edit his books, while others answered letters from around the world, and some took day jobs in town to help out with expenses. All in all, life started to become easier for Billy, and the Sinjace Silver Star Center was becoming well known around the world, and off. As the contacts continued and his pictures were shown in magazines and newspapers around the world, people everywhere became interested in the Swiss farmer who was in touch with the star people. His contacts continued for almost 3 years and produced hundreds of beautiful pictures, metal samples, biological samples, crystals, and stones from other planets. He was even allowed to take over 30 minutes of movie film of the beamships in flight, which was converted to videotape for the world to see. Here, at last, was the kind of proof of extraterrestrial contact that people were looking for. After 115 meetings, the Pleiadians did finally end the contacts on Thursday, October 19, 1978, because they no longer served their interest, but the wave of excitement and intrigue was spreading around the world. Even though the contacts had ended for Billy, they were just starting for the people of Earth. During the final months of the contacts, an investigative team from America led by Colonel Wendell Stevens began to publish the results of their findings. In a wonderful and informative book called UFO Contact from the Pleiades, an investigative report, written by Colonel Stevens, he summarized over 10 months of intensive investigative work that included analysis of landing tracks and photos, testimony of witnesses, detailed study of each contact site where Billy had taken his photos, and hundreds of hours of conversation covering the information about these beings from the Pleiades. It was a significant piece of work that captured the excitement and enthusiasm that surrounded Earth's most important contact with human life from another world in modern times. Other members of the investigative team, Lee and Brett Elders, combined their investigative findings with the beautiful, clear pictures taken by Billy and created an informative and stimulating photo journal called UFO, Contact from the Pleiades. This very professional book stirred the emotions and provided deep insights into the thinking of these off-world visitors. I purchased the books and began to study them with great interest. The investigative report by Wendell Stevens was fascinating and captured my attention for weeks, but I was strangely drawn to the photos of the Pleiadian beamships in the photo journal and couldn't stop staring at them. "This book is important," I said to myself. I just knew it. As I slowly turned the pages, I became more and more certain that this book held some important truths about life from another world. I became obsessed with the book, and for days I could think of nothing else. The implications were very serious, indeed. Here, at last, could be proof of the existence of life on other worlds. And if this was true, then just think what we could learn. I had read every word in the book several times, especially the part that said Meier had the opportunity to have physical contacts with these visitors. They had taken him with them in their ships on many occasions for the specific purpose of educating him on a variety of subjects about life, the universe, religion, history, and science. The Pleiadians even allowed him to ask questions put together by himself and a group of friends from the FIGU, who also seemed to be involved in the contacts. The book answered some of my questions, but didn't go into very much detail. I was hungry for more, and found myself calling directory assistants in Arizona to find the publisher, find the printer, find someone. I had to know more. There was the ring of truth in this book that touched something deep inside of me. I was sure that someone out there was making an effort to get in touch with us. It took just a few calls to reach the Elders, who were located in a small town in Arizona. They had just returned from several months in Switzerland investigating this case. They were very helpful and answered a lot of my questions, offering some new insights into the experiences of Billy Meier that were not in their book. My phone bill was pretty high for a while because I kept calling and asking more questions. It turned out that Billy had more than 115 meetings with these visitors from the Pleiades. He had compiled several books out of thousands of pages of notes taken during his many meetings with them. He was publishing his notes in a set of books called the Contact Notes, but the problem was that the books were all written in German and no English translation had been started yet, so I was cut off from the information. The investigators told me they had put Billy's photos through many different kinds of analysis and could find no evidence of a hoax of any kind. They had investigated other witnesses who had seen the ships, some of whom had also taken photos of the ships. They even had been to the sites where the photos were taken and reconstructed the photo scene for computer comparison. Small models of the beamships were made and taken to the original contact sites where Billy took pictures with the same camera for comparison with his own photos. The shots of the models were then analyzed by computer and photographic experts who were able to detect the models in every case. Billy Meier was indeed taking pictures of some unknown type of craft that appeared to be from another world. Billy had given them metal samples for analysis that he had received from the Pleiadians, which was representative of the type of material that their ships were made of. These metal samples had been turned over to a scientist at IBM named Marcel Vogel, who proclaimed he could identify most of the ingredients of the metal, but not the manufacturing process. It was beyond our technology at the moment and clearly not of this Earth, because the metal would have to have been made in some sort of vacuum process. It seems the investigators were almost losing their own objectivity, and they were having trouble finding any reason to doubt Billy's claims. He truly seemed to be having contacts with human visitors from another world. Hardly a day went by during the next couple of years that Billy Meier's experiences were not on my mind. I seemed to have awakened old thoughts and dreams from somewhere deep inside of me that wouldn't go away. I kept my UFO contact from the Pleiades photo journal out on the coffee table for guests to see. The book's cover was a beautiful shot of one of the flying bean ships just hovering over a grassy knoll with some logs nearby. The shot was so captivating that anyone seeing it couldn't resist opening the book and asking a few questions. I just had to talk about this with other people. I soon discovered that many people had the same kinds of questions about life that I had, and maybe here within the pages of this book some of the questions could be answered. But one book was not enough. I wanted to talk to Billy, read his notes, and learn more. I had traveled through China, most of the East, Europe, Egypt, Japan, and had made 3 trips to the Vatican City, putting together pieces of our humanity. My quest had led me down a lot of trails that always came to the same conclusion: we just don't know very much about life and how we fit into the workings of the universe. There was a different theory everywhere you went, all of them based on some truth, but usually summarized with a lot of guesswork that brought me no closer to the answers that I was looking for. We were still confined to this planet with nothing but our own past experiences to guide us. History had left us on our own to create several thousand years of beliefs, religions, and cults, which always seemed to lead to war and bloodshed rather than enlightenment. I really had to learn more about this. It was time to go to Switzerland, time to visit the Simjace Silver Star Center and meet Billy. I finally made arrangements to visit Billy at his home in Switzerland. His letter said it would be okay for me to stay for the summer and learn all I could. His contacts had stopped and the crowds had died down, so it was a really good time to go. I had written to him and explained how I was very interested in the information from his contact notes that he had published in German, which I couldn't read, and would like to continue my education about his experiences. I had learned enough to frequently give public speeches and lectures about what little I knew about his experiences. But more importantly, I needed to know more for myself. My need to personally grow and understand myself better was driving me to Switzerland and to the home of Billy Meier. Since I own my own business, I put all of my work on hold, packed my bags, and made arrangements to leave for Switzerland and the little rural area called Schmidrudi. This was very exciting, and I felt sure that this was going to be a real time of enlightenment. Actually, I really had no idea of the immense amount of information that was waiting for me. The summer turned out to be a life-changing experience. This is the end of part 4. For more information about the Pleiadian mission, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Again, please visit thepleiadianmission.com. Also subscribe and share this video. Let the whole world know the truth. Thank you for listening. Remember that knowledge is power. Please, don't be left in the dark. Please continue to part 5 in the next video.